Make sure you guys hit the subscribe button if you guys are enjoying the content that we're throwing up. And make sure you guys hit the like button if you enjoy the video. And yeah, let's begin. Members of the Rob Corps, how's everybody doing? How you guys doing today? Hope you guys are enjoying this. As always, if you guys want to see the uncensored versions of these videos, and actually after we're done with the boys, all the uncensored videos are going to be left off of YouTube and we're going to do them strictly on Patreon. But if you guys want to see those, it costs you like a buck. The next one we're doing is Punisher Max, which if any of you guys ever read that, it's intense. It's pretty extreme, like it's especially when you get to the one about the slavers. But dude, this story of the boys is legit. Dude, it's crazy. You know, here's one of the funny things. Whenever I make videos and I get super excited, I love reading through the comments because you guys are like, when Rob gets excited, I get excited. It's really, really cool. But what this does is this picks up with the president of the United States, right? Because what we've talked about in the last couple of videos or so is that essentially the war between the superheroes and humans is essentially starting, right? Like the superhuman war is basically kicking off, right? The first shot was fired in the last video that we did. In this one, everything pops off, right? So like initially we pick up with the president of the United States. Now remember, when it comes to Vought American and when it comes to the president, Vought American does not like Dakota Bob, right? They don't like him because he's the one that's basically preventing Vought American from getting their hands in the cookie jar, so to speak. Vought American wants to basically take superheroes and put them into the military industrial complex, right? Become the sole provider of superheroes for the US military and gain that exceedingly lucrative contract. Dakota Bob has stood in their way. The guy who's the current vice president, he's the one that was put in there by Vought American should anything ever happen to the president. And in order to ensure that nothing like that plays out, the Secret Service is constantly rotated by the president's office in order to ensure that if Vought American were to put somebody in place, that they're rotated out immediately, right? They never really have to worry about Vought American getting in there and kind of screwing everything up, right? Potentially taking out the president. And so as a result of that, the president essentially kind of has a meeting going on, or at least a kind of meet and greet with these various kids, right? Some of whom are special needs and some of whom are just interesting in their own way, but they're showing off like their animals and different things like that, which is kind of cool. And then the president comes across a Wolverine. And Wolverines are little vicious things. They're small, but they're vicious as hell, right? It's kind of crazy. And so as a response to that, one of the guys basically crouches down, or I guess really Vic the Veep crouches down and kind of, you know, messes with the container and then opens it up. And when that happens, that Wolverine immediately goes after the president and kills him. Just like that, the president of the United States dies. And the crazy thing about this is that you would expect if the president was going to be taken out in the boys comic, then it would be some great big huge grandiose thing. And I like how Ennis kind of turns it on his head and sort of pulls the rug out from under us. And he's like, no, he basically just dies in a freak accident. But what this does is it opens the door for Vought American, right? It opens everything up. What we end up doing is kind of picking up with Vought American sort of having this discussion. And it's interesting. Normally we would skim over this. We would kind of skip it and just move on to bigger things. This is kind of intriguing. Vought American seizes the opportunity. But and at first we would kind of look at that and say, well, maybe Vought American were the ones that kind of engineered it, right? They used Compound V to somehow do something to this Wolverine and send it after the president. But that was never the case. Instead, it was just luck of the draw. And Vought American, where they kind of look at that and say, well, you know, we kind of feel a little bit cheated. You know, we were the ones that were sort of planning things out. But hey, I'm not going to look a gift horse in the mouth. It's their chance now to get Vic the Veep, the vice president, into the office of the president based on the natural chain of succession when it comes to any scenario whereby the president cannot perform his actions. And then in turn, get them to a position where it's what they want. The other half of this is the various members of the Seven are kind of asking what next, right? Because the biggest concern that all these members of the Seven have is that with Vought American basically achieving what it was that they were looking for, there's the concern of being replaced, right? There's a concern that Vought American would basically just eliminate them. So it's really them just kind of figuring out what they're going to do, whether or not now is a good time to leave, that sort of thing. And so of course, what ends up happening is you basically end up having a group called Titania, I think it is, or Titanic, or whatever it is. It's some small time group. And basically they've been tasked by Vought American to protect, of course, the head of Vought, as well as his second in command, the woman who's going to go forward and lead Vought American, you know, if something were to happen to him, whether he retired or died or whatever the case is. They're not a great big huge focal point at the moment. They're there just kind of as a means of protection. And that's essentially it, right? They're just kind of be bodyguards and keep an eye on those folks. And that's really all there is to it. And so following this, you kind of have this initial discussion between Billy Butcher and Huey, where Huey basically says he doesn't want to have anything to do with violence anymore. I'm tired of engaging in all this violence. I'll plant bugs. I'll do whatever you need me to do in terms of espionage and stealth tactics and spying and whatnot, but I'm not going to kill anybody anymore. And so the response of Billy Butcher is, okay, like, but just come with me before you do. The issue is that before they leave, suddenly here comes Parallactic, like this kind of joke of a superhero team that comes like barging in there. And the initial look of the boys is like, what in the hell is this? And then it's like, let's take them out. And that's exactly what happens. These guys are taken out like that quick, fast, and in a hurry. And that's when you really begin to realize that with Vic the Veep basically taking the place of the president now, Vought American immediately begins to consolidate power, because you jump to the White House with Vic the Veep and essentially a Vought American employee, more or less, who's kind of like directing the vice president on what to say or speaking directly for him and talking to Director Rayner of the CIA, the one that essentially is in charge of the boys, who in turn funds the boys through CIA money, kind of off the books as a sort of Black Ops wet work team. They basically say all funding for anything stops, right? Like, you give us all your reports, all your information, but you do not engage in any kind of activities of any sort until we can look over what it is that's going on. Essentially, they don't really know the connection between the boys and the CIA, but they suspect it's there. And as a result, they're stopping all of that, right? So the boys aren't going to get paid for anything. But that's kind of the misunderstanding of Vought American, is that for the boys, it's not really about the money. They're doing this because they're against superheroes for the most part, right? They think superheroes need to be contained and controlled. Now, the CIA grants them resources that they wouldn't readily have on their own, but it's not about the paying. That's not the major focal point for them. And so again, jumping back to the boys and basically torturing one of the members of Parallactic, it's basically revealed that this group was sent by Vought American, and that in turn, they end up, you know, inadvertently activating the guy's self-destruct, and they're like, sorry about your luck, and the guy blows up. And that's basically the end of that. And so from there, there's this small piece of information that Huey has that he basically reveals. And this is one of the things that we had talked about, right? When we covered the story of Herogasm, where you basically had the giant of all the superheroes, which you'll get the uncensored version of that on Patreon. But when you had like the whole like of superheroes, basically, and like some of the craziest and most lewd acts that I think I've ever seen, that during that point in time, there was a point where Huey ran into Black Noir, and Black Noir had actually just kind of like literally shoved his up Huey's. And it was weird, and it just seems so strange, right? It seems so weird. But knowing that Huey was there, and knowing Huey was a member of the boys, Black Noir never said anything to anybody. And that's where Huey kind of pitches that. He's like, maybe that's our in, right? Maybe that's our in to get in there to get information that we couldn't readily get from Queen Maeve, or he can smuggle us in and give us the means by which to take the boys out. But because of the fact that he never reported Huey as being at Herogasm, they kind of figure that Black Noir might be somebody who can essentially turncoat. Nobody really knows anything about him. He's a mystery. Nobody knows what he looks like. Nobody knows what his backstory is. He's just there. And so in response to all this, what you end up getting is essentially the boys making their move, right? Where they were told by this guy that Parallactic was sent by Vought American, then it's retaliate. And so what they end up doing is Billy Butcher ends up sending Frenchie and the female directly to where Vought American is with the intention of taking them out. And so following that, again, Billy Butcher and Huey kind of have this conversation where it's one of these things where Billy Butcher still realizes that Huey is kind of averse to violence, right? He doesn't want to commit violent acts. And it's one of these things where Billy Butcher has kind of adopted this mindset where he says, look, man, like that's the nature of the beast. If you're going to do what we're going to do, there's no place for pacifists here, right? There's no place for people who just can't pull the trigger. The world is a harsh and a dark place. Learn to cope with it. And so in order to kind of coax Huey into it, you know, it's something that we've sort of seen him do routinely over time. He really pulls out the big guns. It's the ace in the hole. The only thing he knows to do. What he's done is he's captured A-Train, and he basically says, now's your chance. Do you want to engage in any sort of violence? And so as a result of this, what Billy Butcher does is he plays a tape recording. And the tape recording is the immediate aftermath of A-Train killing Robin at the very beginning of the story. And where he had panicked and he had gone running back to the Seven and basically said, here's what I did, and I'm really kind of freaking out. Their response is, well, leaving is what you should have done. They're very coy about it. Like, yeah, you know, I was fighting some guy and like he went flying into Robin, which smashed her into a wall and she died. And I mean, of course there's gonna be collateral damage. They don't really care, right? There's no real remorse or anything along those lines. And with Huey hearing that, he begins to kind of go on a bit of a warpath. But the other part of this is he also kind of begins to turn on Billy Butcher, right? He's like, stop playing this damn tape. Like, stop playing this. I don't want to hear this anymore. Turn this off. But the reality is Huey needs to hear it, because there's the world in which Huey perceives it. Then there's the world the way it really is. And Huey has just not come to terms with the reality of the world in which he lives. That the world of these superheroes, there really is no redeeming factor here. When he found Starlight, she was the exception to the rule. That's the way it is, right? All these heroes, all these superheroes working for Vought American have basically been given complete and total autonomy with no real form of consequence and all the money and resources in the world. Of course they're going to fall to their darker sides, because there's no consequence for if they do. So long as it's not too extreme and doesn't create a headache for Vought American, it gets swept under the rug. Their stories get retold in a way that's more favorable to make them look good. The money keeps flowing because the sales keep going. And that's it. That's the only thing that really ever matters at the end of it all. And so because of the fact that this is the way the world is, ultimately Huey ends up just basically saying, okay. From there, the conversation on the tape recorder switches over to Starlight. And it's like, well, the various members of the Seven are talking about how, like, well, we have to get a replacement for Lamplighter and so on and so forth. So like, what are we gonna do? And then they're like, well, let's get some in here. Well, let's get some chicks in here. And so then it turns into, well, there's this girl named Starlight. Like, she's young, you know, she's inexperienced, she's naive. We can definitely get her, man. Like, we can definitely bring her on board. And who knows what she'll be willing to do to be part of the Seven, right? She's always idolized the Seven. She'll do anything to be on the team, right? The young girl who goes to Hollywood to make a name for herself. That's basically what this is, right? She's taken advantage of by terrible people. And hearing this played in the tape recorder, hearing how people are treated like toys, treated like pawns, something for the amusement of the members of the Seven, immediately sends Huey on a warpath, and enough is enough. And so the result is that he kicks off the head of A-Train and kills him, and that's the end of him. And so from here, we jump back to Frenchie and the female, basically going on a warpath and taking out Team Titanic. And this team is eliminated quite readily. I mean, you do have Frenchie who loses an arm in the process, and the female's kind of injured to a degree, but nothing really severe for the two of them, right? I mean, I guess losing an arm is kind of severe. But basically, Team Titanic is taken down quick, fast, and in a hurry. And that's the capability of the boys, right? That's what makes them so dangerous, is that you only have two of them here. Now, granted, the female is like she's like a one-woman army. She's almost kind of got this berserker feel to her in terms of her going off on various attacks. Frenchie is a lot more methodical, but he can also be just as crazy as she can. Two individuals out there who can just kind of flip out and just kill everything in sight have managed to take out pretty much all of Team Titanic. And so as a result of that, the Vought American representative basically says, stand down. Nobody do anything anymore, right? Like, all the members of Team Titanic, stop. And that's basically where he really kind of begins to spill the beans. And what he says here is, why are you doing all this in the first place, right? Like, are you really just making your move to attack us? And the response of Frenchie is, no, you sent Paralactic after us. And the Vought representative says, no, we didn't. We never sent that team after you. Somebody else did, and they told that team to lie about who it was that sent them after you. Some third party is trying to get us to fight each other. I need to speak to Billy Butcher. Vought American is extending an olive branch. They're looking to basically have a truce, right? To kind of have a powwow and say, okay, let's compare notes and let's see if we can figure out what's really going on here. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to call my guys. They're going to get here. They're going to tend to you. They're going to get you sorted out. Your arm is gone, so there's nothing to do about that. But like, they're going to get you sorted out. And then I want to talk to Billy Butcher, right? I want to see what's going on with him. From there, we switch over to Queen Maeve and to Starlight. And the reason why is because Starlight is quitting the Seven, right? She's walking away. And Queen Maeve is doing the same thing, right? Starlight's like, look, you can come with me if you want. You don't have to stay here, right? I mean, there's nothing keeping you here. You can leave anytime you want to. If this life really makes you so miserable, then let's just go. And Queen Maeve does, right? The indication is she intends to leave right alongside Starlight. Well, then suddenly the two of them are both met by the arrival of Homelander. And then immediately Queen Maeve realizes what's going on. They're not going to be allowed to leave. Homelander intends to kill them both. And so she reacts with a quickness. She immediately grabs her guy, you know, her manservant guy, who's just like, I'll do anything to, you know, try to touch them. She basically grabs that guy, throws him into Homelander. The guy dies. She grabs Starlight, throws her out of the plane, and then goes to attack Homelander, only to find out the sword she had was a metal prop. Homelander, in turn, punches her head off, and Starlight flees for her life. That's basically what happens. It's kind of amazing, right? Like, it's super cool. But the result of this is that with the Vought American rep, who basically reveals his name to be James Stillwell, where he starts communicating with Billy Butcher, what he basically says is, there's some third party in here trying to get us to fight each other so they can go forward with their agenda. It looks like it's Homelander, right? Like, Homelander is essentially inciting the two of us to go to war with each other so that he can do whatever it is that he's intending to do. So I say we pull our resources together. I say we pull our information together and we go from there. And the response of Billy Butcher is, okay, but like, if Frenchie and the female are not back here in an hour, then like, I'm gonna f*** you up. Like, I'm gonna kill you. And so it's kind of nuts, because what you end up finding out is that in response to all this stuff, the fact that Vought American, you know, James Stillwell, has essentially been picking up on what it is that Homelander's been doing, what's been happening is the military has been organizing itself in response to a potential superhuman threat. Because everybody in the military is kind of picking up on what's going on, that the superheroes appear to be going rogue, right? So in response to that, they basically organize themselves in such a way. That and the fact that all these superheroes basically appeared above the Pentagon, which is really kind of cause for concern, because they were never asked to be there, right? So it looks like the superheroes are engaging in battle formations, which is kind of a cool thing. And so as a result of that, of course, you end up having Billy Butcher, who shows up on the scene. He's given total control over this. I don't know what the nomenclature is, what the term is for like a group, like what this would be in the military, this coming together of Marines. Billy Butcher is given control over them. And initially there's kind of responses about, hey, what's going on at the Pentagon, because they're currently sitting at the White House. And the response of Billy is, the guys in the Pentagon are going to have to hold out as best they can. again, we have to focus our efforts here, right? We have to stay here. We kind of have to keep an eye on what's going on. And then Billy Butcher basically tells Huey, you're to run this place in my stead. I'm going to go into the White House and I'm going to figure out what's going on with regards to the Homelander basically taking up the Oval Office. And that's when Mother's Milk chimes in. And Mother's Milk was essentially tasked by Billy Butcher to previously look into Black Noir, right? Like look into all the members of the Seven, see if there was information that they missed. And Mother's Milk found information about Black Noir that they didn't know before. And when he calls up Huey, he's like, no, you have to keep Billy Butcher from going in there, because if he does, he's going to find something way worse than Homeland. Gonna pop off, right? So as soon as Billy Butcher gets in there, Homelander has already killed Vic the Veep, right? He already killed the sitting president. And then in turn, it's just like kind of going on this bit of a warpath, all while Black Noir is watching it unfold. And that's one of the things, essentially the way that Mother's Milk explains this to us is that what Von American needed was an antithesis to Homelander. That when Homelander first popped up, he was this newborn baby with heat vision, incinerating everything. He was essentially a baby Superman. How do you combat that? That's why they basically had Homelander spend so much of his youth right next to essentially a nuclear bomb, so that if things went off, Vought American could detonate the nuke and they could kill Homelander. But what they realize is that if Homelander were to lose his mind, go on some kind of a rampage, and then Vought American nuked him, that's going to ask too many questions. Where did this nuke come from? Who gave Vought American the authority to fire it? There's too many questions and too many things for Vought American to sweep under the rug. And so what they needed was essentially a countermeasure to Homelander. Enter Black Noir. That essentially the way this played out is that Black Noir himself was created by Vought American. That when Vought American created Homelander, they realized how capable he was, but how dangerous he was. And so what they did in turn is they took the Compound V that resided inside Homelander and then refined it to create a better and more powerful version of Homelander. That resulted in the creation of Black Noir. Black Noir in turn was sent to join the Seven, and nobody knew anything about him, right? Homelander didn't know anything about him. Nobody knew his origin story. They knew what origin story had been made up in the comics, if there even was one, but he was just this mysterious clandestine figure that Homelander seemed to like because he just followed him around and he did what Homelander told him to and didn't really make any objection or anything like that. But his job was to stay and watch, to basically monitor Homelander and ensure that if he went awry, if he went off the reservation, that he would either be wheeled in by Black Noir or just outright killed. And so in response to that, as time began to pass, Black Noir basically came to the realization that his mission was never going to come to fruition, that he was basically tasked as an assassin to eliminate a target if the situation arose, and that situation never came about. Literally, he started going insane, obsessing over a target that he was staying in the close proximity of, but could never actually kill. And that's when you basically end up learning that Black Noir himself is a perfect clone of Homelander, but more powerful. When he removes the mask, that's when you learn what it is. Not only that, because Black Noir had been going insane, all the things that had been done over the course of Homelander's career as a superhero, where it was like cannibalizing children and it was wife of Billy Butcher, where it was all believed to have been done by Homelander, it was all actually done by Black Noir, who put on the suit of Homelander and then committed these various acts, right? So Homelander is indeed an innocent guy, right? Like, he's never actually done anything bad. He's never really done anything wrong, which is wildly crazy, because what Black Noir wanted to do was essentially complete his mission. And so going through and committing all these heinous acts and then blaming Homelander for it, and then taking that information and sending it to Billy Butcher, the source that they didn't know where all that stuff was coming from, by doing that, the hope was that in turn, Vought American, by Billy Butcher and them releasing that information to Vought, that Vought would in turn call for the removal of Homelander, and finally the mission of Black Noir could be complete. That's the entire goal behind everything that seems to have happened so far. It's all the result of what Black Noir has been doing. He basically just ended up going crazy. Not only that, when the Air Force is basically tasked with responding to all the various superheroes above the White House, when they come flying in, weapons hot, all the superheroes who were kind of gathered there are just like, we're superheroes, man. We don't need to worry about them. Why do we care about the Air Force? But in turn, the Air Force starts launching all these modified weapons with like armor-piercing missiles and all that kind of stuff designed explicitly to neutralize superheroes, and all these superheroes are completely eradicated. And that was the failure of the superheroes, believing that they were essentially invincible. They're taken out readily. I mean, this is not like a lengthy conflict. No. It was Judgment Day. It was Judgment Day above the White House. And so because of this, you know, in response to that, essentially, you know, with regards to Black Noir and Homelander and the revelation of what Black Noir has been doing, he and Homelander end up getting into a conflict with each other, and Billy Butcher jets. He's like, okay, so like, these are basically two Homelanders. I got nothing to offer here. He bails out, right? He's like, I gotta go. Like, he basically ends up splitting, and then in turn tells everybody, okay, be ready. Only one of these guys is gonna make it out. And when they do, we gotta be ready to start spraying all this stuff down, right? Start taking all these guys out. We end up finding out that Black Noir Noir had managed to kill Homelander, and that in that process, once Black Noir comes out, despite having been almost completely and totally pulverized by Homelander, is still very much alive. Billy Butcher and everybody else start opening up tank rounds. Like, so you're talking about like these great big huge 50 caliber rounds. You're talking about like tank shells. I mean, the whole nine yards. It all just comes flying out. And where it does do a pretty good chunk of damage to Black Noir, it does not completely incinerate him. Instead, what ends up happening is Billy Butcher ends up showing up basically with a crowbar and pries the head open of Black Noir, more or less killing him. I mean, he doesn't die immediately, but he's on the way to dying. Now, the initial response, I know a lot of you guys are probably going to look at that and say, okay, this is dumb. If tanks and stuff like that couldn't take this guy out, then how's Billy Butcher going to do it? Well, keep in mind, when you're talking about these guys firing tanks, this isn't laser tag, right? Where like you just stand there and you shoot and it's so light and so easy that you can stay on target pretty much 100% of the time. No, I mean, you're talking about a huge amount of recoil, right? So sure, they're spraying and they're shooting, but they're for the most part shooting in his general direction. They might hit him a few times, but like he wasn't hit by all of those blasts. Not only that, keep in mind, Billy Butcher has Compound V. He's super strong. Not on the same level as Black Noir, but he's certainly strong enough to be able to pry the guy's head open with a crowbar, which he does. Basically grabs his brains, rips it out, and says, this is probably the part of your brain with the last few memories you have of taking out my wife, Becky. This is revenge for her. And then in turn, crushing the guy's brains in front of his face, and then Black Noir basically falls over dead. And where you would look at this and you would say, okay, so this is the end of it, right? Billy Butcher ended up getting revenge on the guy who killed his wife. That's not the case. It goes into Punisher mode, right? Billy Butcher kind of says, Becky, you know, I'm sorry, my love. I got revenge for you. You know, I'm sorry. I know you wouldn't have wanted it to happen, but as much as you probably hate what it is that I've done, the honest truth here is you're going to absolutely hate what it is that I do next. With that being said, guys, we're gonna bring this video to an end. If you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like, and I will catch you all later. Peace. I want to say thank you to all of the new patrons who have joined patreon.com/comicsexplained. I want to give a shout out to Henry, Young Typhon, Elias G, David J.S., Jacob H., Ben, John H., Jason C., Austin S., Austin H., James O., Chris T., Matt N., Jeff R., Joey M., Stephen Z., Sloth Like Lou, David C., John H., Lean and Mean. That guy asks questions all the time. Adam K., Genosis 916. I want to say thank you to all of you all. This list is growing all the time. Thank you for joining the Patreon.